Amen. Well, good morning. I want to welcome each one of you to worship this Lord's Day here at Klondike Church. So glad you've gathered and join us as we get the opportunity to go into the presence of our Lord together as a church family. We are thanking God for his goodness today, and I do want to give you just a warm welcome in the world of face masks and air hugs. Good morning to you. If you're in our overflow this morning, we welcome you. Those of you online as well on Facebook, thank you so much for joining us as we do gather together as a church family. We're praising God for many things this week. We had a great time together on Thursday with our just fellowship as a church family. It was really great. We're also praising him because he's working in lives. And in the midst of a crisis, there are great things happening. You all gave blood last week, and up to 24 lives were saved because you gave blood. So thank you to everyone who was able to give for that hour after service last Sunday. The Bloodmobile will actually be back on campus this Wednesday. If you didn't get to give and you'd like to, you can check online. There's more info about when they'll be here. I think it's 10 to 3. Also, we're thankful for Wednesday nights. Every Wednesday night, we have our Bible study together on Zoom. It's a great time. Know that you're invited to be a part of that. We're studying the great book, Precious Remedies Against Satan's Devices by the Puritan minister Thomas Brooks. And we'd love to have you in that Bible study every Wednesday at 6:30. So if you need info, let me know. Contact the church office. We will get it to you. If you're a guest today, please know we are glad you are here. And if you would just take a moment and go online to our website, lovepensacola.org/connect. If you're watching online, if you would do the same, we would just love to know you're here. Love to be able to send you an email and say thanks for being a part of the service today. And if we can pray for you or serve you in any way, you can put that as well in the comments. But we do say good morning to you. Our church exists to be a church that's passionate about proclaiming and living the gospel. By loving God and this community of Pensacola, he's placed us in for his kingdom and glory. And that's what we seek to do as a church family every single week. And we will this morning seek to love God with all our hearts. So please stand as Brother Frank comes and he gives us our call to worship today from God's holy word.
Our call to worship comes from Psalm chapter 145, where David writes, "The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and great in mercy. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works. All your works shall praise you, O Lord, and your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and talk of your power." Let us pray. Father in heaven, as we come into this place today, we pray that you rid our hearts and minds of all the distractions of the week behind us and of the week ahead, reminding us that in the week behind us and the week ahead, God, you are king over all, and all power and authority belongs to you and to you alone. May we come into this place today, we renew our covenant with you. May our worship be a sweet aroma to heaven in your heavenly name. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Come praise and glorify our God, the Father of our Lord. In Christ he has in heavenly realms his blessings on us poured. For pure and blameless sin he destined us to be, and now we've been adopted through his Son eternally. To the praise glory, to the praise of your mercy and grace, to the praise of your glory. You are the God who saves. Come, praise and glorify our God, who gives his grace in Christ. In him our sins are washed away, redeemed through sacrifice. In him God has made known to us the mystery of his will, that Christ should be the head of all his purpose to fulfill. To the praise of your glory, to the praise of your mercy and grace, to the praise of your glory. You are the God who saves. The Spirit of the Lord. The Spirit guarantees our hope until redemption's done, until we join in endless praise to God the Three in One. To the praise of your mercy and grace, to the praise of your glory. You are the God who saves. To the praise of your glory, to the praise of your mercy and grace, to the praise.
Please join with me as we pray a prayer for mercy. Let your continual mercy, O Lord, cleanse and defend your church. And because it cannot continue in safety without your help, protect and govern it always by your goodness. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flame. Upon it, mount of thy Redeemer. And here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I hope
Seated.
The Lord Jesus Christ, in his great mercy to us, invites us to come to him at this time with all of our burdens of the past week, all of our brokenness, and to lay our hearts before him and confess our sins together. So join me and let us confess our sins to a holy God. Turn yourself to me and have mercy on me, for I am lonely and afflicted. The troubles of my heart have enlarged. Bring me out of my distresses. Look on my affliction and my pain, and forgive all my sins. In Jesus' name, amen. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy towards those who fear him. And as far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from us. Let us pray. Our God, we come now in thanksgiving to you because you, by your resurrection from the dead on the first day of the week, have sanctified and hallowed and set apart this day for your church to gather together. The very meaning of this calling of being the church is to come together as a people, and we join with the saints in heaven, with the angels in heaven in this act of worship. We join with saints all around the world, brothers and sisters in Latin America, in Africa, Lord, in Europe, in Australia. Lord, we thank you for the church united, one body, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. And we come today recognizing that while we are weak individually, there is power in the Holy Spirit and in the unity of the one true faith. We thank you for the gospel that changes our lives. We thank you that above all else, our hearts can be set on something that matters, not the trivial things that will only stand temporarily. Lord, calm us, still us now. Remove our restlessness. For those battling addictions, for those this morning that are battling sin, sins of our thoughts, sins of consumption, sins of pride, Lord, help us today with your mercy to look to you and you alone, O Christ, with the singular eye of faith, and may we find the freedom and strength in you, Christ Jesus. For those whose health is under siege this morning because of the weakness of the body, because of the coronavirus, Lord, we pray for those who are battling anxiety and depression, that today we would set our hearts on you, O God, that you would grant us wisdom to know that even in our weakness, in minds that are struggling and racing, you are still King, and you use that which is weak and even broken, and you heal it, and you put it back together, and you strengthen it, and God, you even help it to persevere. We pray today for those who are in the hospital. We pray for all of our hospitals in Pensacola right now, for those serving at West Florida Hospital, and those serving at Baptist Hospital and Ascension, Sacred Heart. We pray, God, that you would grant endurance to those in the healthcare field. We pray for our leaders. We pray for our governor, for President Trump, and others this day, that you would give them wisdom in how to help this nation. We pray for your mercy. We do not deserve it, but we plead for it because you are a good God. We pray today for those who are shut in, for those who are sick and cannot be here, for Lucille Searles and Lydie Berry and Nelry Williams and Johnny and Betty McGallagher and Gloria White. Pray for Laura Kreitler, Lord. Please help each one of these brothers and sisters and others that we haven't named today. You know their names. Why they're not here, help them, Lord. For business owners, help them to seek to have your wisdom and how to operate in such days as today. Father, I pray that you would be glorified in our hearts and minds as we continue to worship you. Please speak, O Lord. We ask in Jesus' holy name. And God's people said, Amen. Please take your Bible at this time. I want to invite you to turn with me to the book of Psalms, chapter 14, for our responsive reading and our prayer today from the 14th chapter of the Psalms. Psalm 14, we'll look at the whole chapter, verses 1 through 7. And I'll ask you to follow along and join with me in the even verses as we pray and read together this God's holy word. The inscription of this is to the chief musician. It's a psalm of David. So it was made to be sung as well as to be prayed. Again, join with me in the even verses and remember that the reading of God's word is an act of worship. May we humbly submit to what is said here as our own prayers to God. Join me in the even verses. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. They have done abominable works. There is none who does good. The Lord looks down from heaven upon the children of men to see if there are any who understand, who seek God. They have all turned aside. They have together become corrupt. There is none who does good, no, not one. Have all the workers of iniquity no knowledge, who eat up my people as they eat bread, and do not call on the Lord? There they are in great fear, for God is with the generation of the righteous. You shame the counsel of the poor, but the Lord is his refuge. Oh, that the salvation of Israel would come out of Zion, when the Lord brings back the captivity of his people. Let Jacob rejoice and Israel be glad. This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. God, we pray now that you would bring back the captivity of your people, minds that are captive to fear, hearts that are captive to worry, hands that are captive to sin, mouths that are captive to blasphemy and brokenness, feet that are captive to walk in the wrong way. Bring us back today. Lord, be our refuge today. Be with our brother, Cody Mathews, as he opens your most holy word. Speak to us, O Lord. May we not say with foolishness in our hearts that there is no God. Instead, may we bow before you as you look down from heaven and we call upon you, O Lord. Be with this, your people that are righteous, not because of us, but because of your blood, Jesus Christ. We pray in your precious and holy name. And God's people said, amen.
Like Pastor Josh says, my name is Cody Mathews. I grew up right down the road. I even attended this church many a time as a kid with one of my friends. My wife and children couldn't be here this morning, but we are the Mathews family pursuing missions in Peru. It's great to be here. And just first off, I want to just say thank you, because last year, before language school, I was here raising awareness, raising support, for support to be able to go to language school, and this church helped out tremendously. So I want to say thank you. It was a great blessing. It was really a wonderful investment to be able to study full time before we go to the mission field with my wife. My last Sunday, I got to preach in Spanish to a Costa Rican church, which was the most scariest and intimidating thing I've ever done. There is nothing more humiliating than learning another language. And since Costa Rica, God has blessed us to be able to have language tutors to kind of keep us from forgetting and becoming too rusty. So we're still pressing in. Still have a lot to go, actually. But thank you for your prayers. We truly believe God gave us a lot of victory and grace because of the prayers of God's people back home. You go to the next slide. Just to give a brief reminder what we're doing. Why Cusco, Peru? What will I be doing? For those of you who do not know, Latin America, Central and South America, contain 35% of the world's Protestants. Isn't that absolutely incredible? 35%. Christianity is very new there. Last week at church, I had a Brazilian family come up to me and share how in the 1800s, a missionary from America and his family came to Brazil. And now thinking of the millions of Christians that there are in Brazil. However, because of lack of resources and things of that nature, there is great need of training, great need of equipping. Pastor Josh goes to Colombia every year and trains pastors. Latin America is in great, great need for leaders and elders to be equipped to be able to preach and to be able to shepherd the people of God. God is working so great in Latin America. It's amazing. And I feel it is our duty as believers to pass the baton. Think about what's happening in the West, with Europe rejecting the Lord. Think of where our culture is going. I truly believe Latin America is the new central zone of Christianity for the world. It is amazing. And it is my great honor. You can go to the next slide. It's my honor. Well, actually, that's too fast. Sorry, wrong one. My fault. It's my honor to be able to devote full time into training up leaders and pastors. So I'll be partnering with the Chotskys for the Gospel Seminary. Chotskys were Incan messengers who would take messages throughout the Incan Empire on behalf of the king. A really fitting title for the seminary. For example, I have up here the IEP Church, which is a mainline Baptist denomination in Peru, has 2,000 churches and roughly 170 full-time pastors. It's very tragic. They've had a handful of them die from the coronavirus. In fact, one of the brothers that I partner with, who oversees for the whole denomination, raising up leaders, almost died himself. So Peru is being really hit heavy with the coronavirus right now. Also, you can go to the next slide now, brother. Sorry. Also, why is Cusco important? If you could see the scattered buildings, tragically, there are still hundreds of isolated villages with little or no access to the gospel. And it is very important for them to receive the good news of God in Christ Jesus. And so I will be laboring to not only train pastors and leaders, but to bring the gospel to communities such as this through my ministry, through going and taking my family, and through the men and women that we mobilize. So we're going and asking churches. You could go to probably to the next couple ones. See, that's one. You can keep going. I kind of covered that. Go to the next one again. We are going around asking churches and people to help make this possible. We are self-supporting, meaning we have to raise our own funds. It's very difficult to raise funds during a pandemic, right, with churches closed. That was a great rude awakening when we got back from language school. However, God has been faithful and has been providing for us. So I ask you to pray for two things for us. Other than the normal things, spiritual things, and for, you know, our family. I ask you to pray for Peru, for God to open up doors. They've been so hit by this pandemic that they re-quarantined the whole country. And they've been there in quarantine since March. And we often wonder, what will this country be like when we come? And so it's been hit hard. And so one mountain that we have for God to throw into the sea is just to open the border up. So we're waiting. And the second mountain, which is becoming more like a hill for us, praise be to God, is that we still need $1,180 a month coming in before we can go. So we're asking people, we know that not everybody is able because of the pandemic. And if you're not able, we are not asking. You know, if you are able, prayerfully consider $10, $15, $20. You know, if 100 people gave us $10 a month, we can go. But first and foremost, pray for us, and thank you so much for your support. Anyway, so if you'll open your Bibles with me to Isaiah chapter 52. Isaiah chapter 52, we're going to start in verse 13, and we're going to cover all the way through Isaiah 54. We'll spend most of our time in Isaiah 54. So if you'll, let's start things off by praying together. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we're so grateful for your grace and for your mercy in Christ Jesus. Lord, we're thankful, Lord, for your promises that I will strengthen you, I will help you, I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And so God, I pray that as your word is open, that it would be your word. I pray for your Holy Spirit's power to be able to speak to your people this morning. And Father, I pray you would give us all ears to hear and hearts to obey. And I pray, God, that after this, that this sermon would result in more people gathering around the throne of God forever. In Jesus' name, amen. What an amazing picture just to think about people from every tribe, tongue, and nation praising the risen Christ in heaven forever. What greater thing? And it is amazing that what we do on earth can affect that. It's amazing to see such a big sovereign God from before the foundation of the world determining these things and finishing the mission. Christ purchasing a people before the foundation of the world. Those who would be written in the Lamb's Book of Life were written. I believe in a very sovereign, big God. But what is amazing is the privilege that God gives his people. That God calls his church to be the instruments by which he uses to advance his kingdom. What a wonderful thing is God's people. What a high and mighty calling he's given his church. High and mighty. Not just for the church global, the universal church, but for local churches as well, like Klondike. And not even just for local churches, but for individual believers with the indwelling Holy Spirit to be a part of this mission. God has called each and every one of us. And I want to say to God's people this morning, to those in the other room, to those watching online, that God is still doing big and mighty and great things in this earth. That Christ is still redeeming a people, that mission, for the whole reason for which God created the world, is still in the process of being fleshed out. The church, we could still expect great things from God. With that being said, however, again, I'm not even just addressing the church universally or the church locally, but for each individual believer indwelt, born again with the Holy Spirit of God, that you can attempt great things for God. Maybe that phrase, you've heard that before, expect great things from God, attempt great things for God. Of course, I'm not brilliant enough to have coined that phrase. I'm stealing that from the missionary William Carey. That was his slogan. Expect great things from God, attempt great things for God. But what I love about that slogan, it's not just a slogan, which I believe is the greatest two sermon points in church history. Incredible. But it's highly theological. And it's from the very texts that we're going to be studying today. And so I will not do this text justice this morning. I suppose that an angel could come and try to exposit these texts. He couldn't do it. Couldn't do it justice. There is glory in this text. Glory that we will not wear out for all of eternity. So, church, the title of today's message is to expect great things from God and to attempt great things for God. So first, I want to start out why. Why can we expect great things from God today in 2020? Let's read together Isaiah 52, verse 13. Again, we're just going to jump around a little bit. Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. Here, the prophet Isaiah prophesies about the coming Christ 700 years before Jesus would walk this earth and talks as if the servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up. He shall be succeeded. He shall succeed in his mission. And I love the way Isaiah talks about this work that the suffering servant would do. He's speaking as if it's something in the future, but he's talking about it in past tense, as if it's already happened. That is how successful God is in his purposes. That is how certain they are that God could talk about them, something in the future, but as if it's already happened. Church, we can have great confidence and the promises and purposes of God. We're told that Jesus would succeed in his mission. What was the mission of God? We're reminded in the book of Genesis of the promised offspring from Adam and Eve that would crush the head of the serpent. And then as you read a little longer, it talks about that line of the offspring is talked about. And God's preserving this offspring. And then it would be through the lines of Seth. And then from Seth to Noah. And from Noah, God says to Abraham, through your offspring, all of the nations of the world would be blessed. And then history goes on a little bit longer. And then God says to David, David, through your son will come the offspring that'll rule and save the world. And we read the very opening statement in the book of Matthew, Jesus Christ, the son of Abraham, the son of David. He's come. He succeeded. Then we read the very end of the Bible and we see the nations coming and worshiping before Christ. people from every tongue, tribe, and nation. We can expect great things from God because of what Jesus Christ, the suffering servant, has accomplished for the world. Verse 14. As many as were astonished at you. It's like he pauses. There's a pause here. Because what he's about to say is so heavy. So unbelievable. His appearance was so marred beyond human semblance. And his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which has not been told of them, they see. And that which they have not heard, they understand. To me, these are the most astounding sentences in all of human language. That the Son of God, the Prince of Glory, the King of Glory, would leave heaven and become marred beyond all human semblance, that you couldn't even tell he was a man, so that he could sprinkle many nations with his blood. Why would Jesus do such a thing? Because of his great love. We can expect God to do great things because of his heart for the nations, his purpose for the nations. God loves the world. And he succeeded. And he succeeded. He says in verse 10 of Isaiah 53, yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Brothers, this is speaking of the resurrection of Christ. The conquering, succeeding work of Christ, and God's will prosper in his hand. He did complete the mission. So church, expect great things from God, because we are in the day of salvation where God is fulfilling his purposes in the world. And he's not done. And he's not done. So that is why we can expect great things from God, because Jesus has succeeded in God's purposes for the world. All right, Isaiah 54, if you'll turn there with me. So we've seen what God is doing. I love Isaiah 54 because there's a transition. This truth, some of the most glorious truths in all of Scripture are here, and yet it hinges on what is said in Isaiah 53. So we are going to talk about the glories that we have in Christ. And I want you to read it all through the lens of the suffering servant and what God has done in him. So we're going to talk about not only why we can expect great things from God, but why you can attempt great things for God. Isaiah 54 talks about, again, because of the suffering servant. This is a therefore, in light of this, he says, sing. The first thing he says to his people, sing, cry out, praise him. This work that he has done is so good. Your first response, sing. Brothers, not only, and sisters, not only is it our first response, it will be our last response too. It'll never grow old. We'll never stop singing about it. For all of eternity, we will gather with the angels and with all the Lord's hosts and with the redeemed, and we will still be singing. Because of what the suffering servant has done and is doing in the world, sing. He says, sing, O barren one who did not bear. Break forth into singing and cry aloud, you who have not been in labor. For the children of the desolate one will be more than the children of her who is married, says the Lord. See, Israel failed and what they were called by God to do. They were called to be a priest for the world, a kingdom of priests, and to bring forth many children, many offspring for God. They failed. But God is saying, I'm raising up a true and greater Israel, the Israel of God, and he succeeded. And because of his work, Israel, you're going to have many, many children. Israel, your offspring will inherit the nations. He's saying, because of Jesus, you're going to have countless offspring. And who is the offspring he is talking about? He's talking about the church. He's talking about God's people from every tribe, tongue, and nation. He's talking about the fulfillment of the Abrahamic promise. So we are bearing, we are enjoying the fruit of the suffering servant, worshiping God in Pensacola, Florida, thousands of miles away from where all this stuff happened. God's promises are true. He tells them, enlarge the place of your tent, Israel, and let the curtains of your habitations be stretched out. Do not hold back. Lengthen your cords. Strengthen your stakes, for you will spread abroad to the right and to the left, and your offspring will possess the nations and will people the desolate cities. God saying, Israel, you barren woman who did not bear, you're going to have so many spiritual children that it's going to cover the four corners of the world. And even for those isolated villages that we saw in those pictures, even the desolate regions of the world, in the deserts and in the mountains and over the seas, shall know the living God, that God in Christ is doing a global salvation. God's saying to Israel, you're going to need a bigger tent. This is the text that William Carey used when he said, expect great things from God. Why can we expect great things from God? Because this is the church age, brothers and sisters. We are still in the enlarging of the tent. Enlarge the place of your tent. Strengthen. These are commands in their present tense. They keep going. So we can expect great things from God because we're living in the church age, brothers. I was talking to Brother Tommy this morning and I said, if that's not a sermon illustration, I don't know what is. Please, Lord, help me to remember this one. So I remembered it. Thank you, Lord. He was talking about catching mullet and how the other day he was out at the beach, didn't bring his net, but somebody in one cast caught 20 mullet. Right? Praise the Lord. And he said he's on a Facebook group with fishermen. And they asked the question, what is the last thing you think about when you cast your net? And he said, that God gives the increase. And then he shared this story about this being the reality and how you can even Google fishermen who've had a boatload of fish and it's almost sinking, but they're chugging along with a grin from ear to ear. That's the church age, brothers. That is the church age. That is the era in which we live. God is saying, cast the net. I cause the increase. Cast the net. I will cause the increase. I love the image that God gives the disciples. You know, they're fishing all night and all day and they don't catch anything. But then Jesus tells them to cast their net and he does. And it almost sinks the boat. This was a foreshadowing of their ministry. A foreshadowing of the church age. Brothers and sisters, God is still calling his people to cast out your net. We live in some very crazy times. I don't need to bring everything up. Maybe you're like me and you wonder, what is the America that you live in? What is it becoming and what will it be? How will this virus affect all of the world? And you just see conflict after conflict. And we live in a time where people bite and devour one another and hate one another. And you think, what is happening? But I can tell you this. I don't know. But I can tell you who wins. I can tell you who's won. And I can tell you what God is still doing. He is still doing great things. There will still be great revivals on this earth. There will still be people won for the Lord. There still will be kings being exposed to the gospel, like this text says. There is victory and there will be victory, even if all hell breaks loose on the church, which it's been doing for 2,000 years and which it will continue to do, but the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. So church, cast out your nets. Lengthen your cords. And expect great things from God. I love how so true to the scriptures, the analogy, or it wasn't an analogy, it was a real experience of the time of William Carey when he preached this. Do you realize he was brought before the elders of the church and expressed the desire for missions? And he was rebuked severely. Severely. If God wants to reach the nations, by golly, he is going to reach the nations. Therefore, we don't do anything. Oh, what bad theology that is. Sometimes we kind of, we function like that though, even though we would say that we don't dare believe that. Brothers and sisters, the sovereignty of God is not meant to keep us on our seats. It's meant to give us boots. It's meant to get us bloody and dirty. And to get out there is to give us confidence in prayer. It's to give us generosity, reckless generosity. It's to help us to be willing to take great costs, knowing that there is great success, and there will be. But I don't think with us, predominantly, it's a theological issue. You believe that God's still doing great things. You believe that there, God is sovereign, but we must preach the gospel. We must pray. We must obey God, that we are the means by which he uses. But perhaps you're like me, and it's not theological. Maybe it's your heart. Maybe it's insecurities. Maybe it's certain types of excuses. Like, who am I? You're expecting great things from saying all these things. I'm poor. I have nothing. You seen the size of my house? I'm all alone. I'm disabled. Or little old me, I'm nothing like Pastor Josh, or I'm nothing like any of these people. Maybe you're like me and that's more of your bend. Little old me. Brothers, what we are going to see from Isaiah 54 is that God absolutely dismantles any excuse, any fear, any theological error that we may have, that you are the instruments that God is wanting to use, and he could use you mightily. So I say to you from God's word, enlarge your tent. Attempt great things. For God, yes, little of you. Because as we get this beautiful glimpse of this great theological concept that God has accomplished, we must remember that we are called to obey and do something. But we must also remember that just like William Carey, when we step out and do something, God's not going to let us fall on our face. But the modern missionary movement, no missions was being done. And since this great sermon, millions, perhaps billions, have believed upon Christ. And God is still doing those types of things. Even with little old you, I love the diary of John Patton, the biography, where in the Church of Scotland, there was a man who oversaw the missions. And he had heard about the need of the cannibal tribes and the New Hebrides. And he prayed with blood, sweat, and tears. He couldn't go. He was an elderly man. But he wanted so bad for God to raise up two missionaries to go. And he prayed and he prayed and he prayed and he tried to rally around the church. The churches even began to see the need, and they even went to casting lots. Let's see who gets the most tallies under their name, and perhaps God will be calling them. That was unsuccessful. And God at this time had been stirring in the hearts of John Patton. He had been seeing the need and seeing the burden to go. And then finally, when he and another brother were, it was confirmed that they were called to go, that Dr. Bates, the gentleman who had been praying for all these years, was on his deathbed. And on his deathbed, he had no rest because he told his daughter to go fetch for the news to see if these two brothers were approved to be able to go. And she came back. This man's on his deathbed. He's not giving his last words. He's saying, what's the status? I must know before I can die. She comes back bringing the good news that they were affirmed and that they're going. And he rejoiced. And he said, my work is complete. I could now die. And then he declined fast and died. So when I'm talking about attempting great things from God, don't think I'm saying that you have to be William Carey or you have to be John Patton. Perhaps you could be Dr. Gates. Because what we will see is that God calls the church to pray. How many of us will take on the prayer, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Brothers, you can expect, you can pray that. And just as Brother Tommy casts out his net and says, Lord, you're the one who gives the increase, can utter that prayer in faith and say, Lord, you're the one who gives the increase. How many people will be in the throne of God forever? Peoples that spoke a foreign language that you never met, but they're worshiping Christ forever because you prayed and God raised up people to go. What's amazing about what happened with Dr. Gates is God didn't just send two missionaries. He eventually sent an army. That's the way it works, brothers. Expect, attempt. We must obey. We must pray. We must give. We must go. And God gives the increase. Here's why you, little old you sitting there, like me, can attempt great things for God. Because his first thing he says to his people, in verse 4, he said, well, what if I put myself out there? What if I give? What if I go? What about who knows what? What's his first words? He says, fear not. Fear not. That is the most said command and exhortation of God to his people. Fear not. So if you go to put yourself out there for God, fear not. He says, for you will not be ashamed. You will not be confounded. For you will not be disgraced. For you will forget the shame of your youth and the reproach of your widowhood. You will remember no more. For your maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name. The Holy One of Israel is your redeemer. The God of the whole earth he is called. God is giving these glorious promises to a people who had been in pretty much complete rebellion to him for 800 years. Perhaps you have things in your past, things that bring you shame. God says to his people, you will forget your shame. You will forget your widowhood. Do not let your past failures keep you from moving forward. Why? Because God's great love for you. He says, for your maker is your husband. What incredible words from God. How do you view God's view of you? He says, God is your maker, he's your husband, and he's your redeemer. When God redeemed Israel from the bondage of slavery, he didn't just set them free to then go be a people. He set them free to be his people. That is why God saved you. He saved you unto himself. And then he says, is your husband. There is nobody I love to spend more time with on this earth or that I love more than my wife. I was telling her the other day how we had company over. It was go, go, go. We had no private space with the whole house. I'm like, I am so stressed. I'm at my wit's end. I just want to go be alone with you and hang out with you. That's how I'm going to veg and detox. Brothers, do you see that God views you this way? The bride of Christ. He says, verse 6, For the Lord has called you like a wife deserted and grieved in spirit, like a wife of youth when she is cast off, says your God. For a brief moment I deserted you, but with great compassion I will gather you. In overflowing anger, for a moment I hid my face from you, but with everlasting love I will have compassion on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. He's saying, Israel, this 70 years of exile that's coming up, it'll be just like a blink. Then you will forever have favor with me. I will never be angry with you again. And then God continues to build on that logic, and it gets more and more glorious. Verse 9, for this is like the day of Noah to me. As I swore that the waters of Noah should no more go over the earth, so I have sworn that I will not be angry with you and will not rebuke you. Oh, I can't be used by God, little old me. God is saying to his people who are in Christ, I will never be angry with you ever again. Do you know in Christ you have that type of favor with him? And you think that is too good to be true. Remember him who was so mutilated that you couldn't realize he was a man. That's what it cost. That's what it costs Christ. But look at what he purchased for you. Yes, God will discipline his people. In the Word of God, he's even disciplined his people so that they would die. But it was all from a motive of love so that they would be spared the wrath of God one day. Children of God, you have this type of favor with you, with God. Our sins can grieve him. Our lives could be deserving of his discipline at times, but it is all from a loving father's heart. The highest courtroom has been settled. There's no charge that could be brought against God's elect. He said, it's like the days of Noah to me. Remember when God destroyed the whole world because of their wickedness, but saved Noah and his family. And then God put a war bow in the sky, the rainbow, facing upward towards God. And he said, every time I see this bow, I will remember to not flood the earth. Isaiah is taking that and applying it to his people because of the suffering servant. I used to, whenever I would see a rainbow in the sky, I would think, wow, God is so faithful to his promise. But now, because of this text, I look at it and see, God will never be angry with me in Christ ever again. Then he says in verse 10, as if he had to say more, for the mountains may depart and the hills be removed, but my steadfast love shall not depart from you, and my covenant of peace shall not be removed, says the Lord who has compassion on you. Wow. I remember when I was jogging in Costa Rica, there was this path on the side of a mountain, these glorious tropical green mountains, volcano in the background, you know, tropical fruit that you can just pick from. Absolutely amazing. And I was on a jog just thinking about God's providence in my life and the things that he had brought me from and how privileged I was. I'm like, I'm learning another language to go serve the Lord. And I'm thinking about the pits he had brought me through in my life. Just thinking, man, if I could see this moment then, how great would that be? But as I'm running, I'm looking at the mountains just in this all amazement, and I'm listening to a sermon on this very text. And it says, the mountains may depart and the hills be removed, but my steadfast love shall not depart from you. I thought that these mountains are more likely to be cast into the sea than for God's love for me be removed. And it took a long time for God to work this into my heart, church. Because I used to say, yeah, God loves me. He loves his church. I had no problem saying that for the church. And I would claim it for myself. But then things would happen in my life and I would see the tendencies that would make things that would make me depressed, the things that would make me anxious, or how would I would approach God, or types of insecurity in my heart. And I realized, I don't believe this the way I thought I did. And God took me through the furnace till I finally learned to believe this, not just for the church, but for myself. And I'll tell you, church, that there is enough glory in this text that God will not remove his steadfast love for you forever to bring you out of a million afflictions. Amen. A million afflictions. The moment you little by little learn how to apply this in Christ to your life will be changed. Talk about an armor. Why can I expect great things from God? Because God loves me. Do you realize, church, in Christ, you will only be loved by God forever? Amen. That is what his steadfast love means. It's his covenant love, where God gives all of himself to that person in love forever. Go in that armor and take on the world for Jesus. When my kids approach me, they come to their father, and I, just like all the rest of us, can discipline and anger at times and, you know, be impatient. But for the most, but my kids never approach me with fear, or they never go and do something without the knowledge that my daddy loves me. I am secure. I am secure. There is a securing. There is a security of a fatherly love that it can give to his children. What happens to families when the father is gone and the father is absent? See how it destroys a family? It destroys a society. But what happens when you have a family with a father that loves them unconditionally, will discipline them when they need to, and teaches them, cares for them, and enjoys them? There is a security in that brings. If you step out in faith, will God's love fail you? No. So I want to challenge you. What are the things that make you depressed? What are the things that keep you from worshiping the Lord freely without hindrance? Can you not see your sins cast as far as the east is from the west? God's removed that. Can you not see your shame and your guilt put on the suffering servant? Can you not see the favor that we now have with Christ? And I'm not talking about everybody else. I'm talking about you. Believe this from your heart. Begin to apply it, and it will change you. Little by little, each day. And then go take on all of hell with a water pistol. Lastly, so I'll skip to the very last point. There's so many great things to say. We could talk about God's finishing the work that he started in us. He starts to compare Israel to a city that has precious jewels. He's comparing this barren city that's about to be ravished by Babylon and taken into exile. But he compares them to a beautiful and glorious city. And then at the end of the Bible, in Revelation, the Bible closes with an angel coming to the Apostle John and saying, come, let me show you the bride of Christ. Let me show you the bride. And then he says, and then a city, then a new heaven and new earth came down. And its city was filled with precious diamonds. Brothers and sisters, God is going to complete the work in our life. God's going to finish what he started. Lastly, I'll say, verse 15, if anyone stirs up strife, it's not from me. Whoever stirs up strife with you shall fall because of you. Behold, I have created the smith who blows the fire of coals and produces a weapon for its purpose. I have created the ravager to destroy. No weapon that is fashioned against you shall succeed. You shall refute every tongue that rises against you in judgment. For this is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication from me, declares the Lord. God says to his people, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. Perhaps it's fear of what can happen. I struggle with that sometimes. What's going to happen? You know, what will I be like in 5 years? What will the world be like? What will blah, 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 blah. And it's like God comes back and says, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. What fear keeps you from serving Christ with all of your heart? Isaiah says here, and this whole logic of Isaiah 53 and 54, the suffering servant, and then this incredible favor we have with God, is the Old Testament picture of what Romans 8:31 says. And I'll close by just reading this. Let God's word speak to your heart. Let God's word speak to your heart. Don't think about this. If you are in Christ, think about this for you personally. Think about this. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is it to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword, as it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all of these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. I want to read this last verse. And I want you to think about it for yourself. I used to think that I needed something special to be able to say what Paul says. But then I realized Paul is not saying this because Jesus appeared to him, knocked him off his horse, and he had this incredible encounter with Jesus. He says that this is true of him because of the logic of what he just said. If God gave up his son for us, how will he not also give us everything else that God has purposed for us in Christ? How will he not give us our full salvation and everything that that salvation was meant to bring for us? All of these realities. How will he withhold any of that when he gave up the biggest thing he possibly could, his son? And so I want you to view these promises through the lens of Jesus Christ dying and raising for you, and pray that God will allow you to, by faith, behold Christ and be able to say this, what Paul says, that you can take these words for you, and then you go and you expect God to do great things, and you go and you attempt great things for God in whatever ways that God empowers you and his providence has given you. Listen to what he says, church. For I am sure, I'm convinced, I am persuaded. Is your heart persuaded of these things? Is your heart convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord? Amen. Amen, brothers. May God help us to be persuaded. Let's pray. Father, we're so thankful, Lord, that if it was up to the strength of our faith, God, even the size of our faith is so unworthy. Even our faith, God, the size of our faith cannot help us to obtain heaven. Lord, if it wasn't for Christ, Lord, we have nothing. And Father, I pray you would help our unbelief. I pray, God, that we would not do you disservice by believing anything less than what Christ has done for us. And help us, Lord, in our fallen nature, in our sin, and in our temptations to put on this armor. And help us extinguish the fiery darts of Satan with your love. For those who are lonely, I pray for your love to satisfy. To those that are fighting hurt, I pray for your love and favor to be the healing balm to their soul. For those who are depressed and in despairing, I pray they would find great hope and confidence. For those who are by faith pressing on, I pray that you would give them the water of the word to refresh them of your great love. And God, we want to pray that you would do a great thing, Lord. We have one life. We have one life, Lord. And we as God's people collectively say that we ask of you to still do great things. To do great things, Lord, in America. Please don't be done with our country, Father. We ask for great things in Peru and in Latin America. Father, I pray that these brothers that we're going to train and to share lives with and to labor partnering alongside, that you would do great things in their lives and in their churches. And that you would do great things, Lord. Even from this congregation, I pray you would begin to call people out to go. Lord, I pray you would encourage us this morning with your acceptance in Christ. Help us to be faithful, Lord. Faithful in prayer and in love and in life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much. We have been fed the word of God today, and now we respond to that message by being fed from the Lord's table. Jesus himself feeds us. I want to read to you just two verses and then call you to come forward to this table. 1 Corinthians 11, 26 and 27 says, as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. Let me ask you in this meditation, what does it mean to be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord? It means today that you join with Pilate, who wrongfully condemned Jesus and then hypocritically washed his hands trying to absolve guilt. It means that you join the crowds that shout out, crucify him. This means that you join the crowds that cry out, give us Barabbas. This means that you join those who use the cat of nine tails to strike Jesus, who plaited the crown of thorns on his head. You join those who nailed his hands and feet. The worthy receiver of this table that we are going to take of is nourished and fed by Jesus. It's like eating of the tree of life in the Garden of Eden. You literally commune with Jesus. He's here with us in this room. And he blesses you with the bread and the cup of salvation. But if you take of this in an unworthy way, it's like you eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It's like you drink a cup of the wrath of God and damnation instead of drinking of the cup of salvation. Now that's a sober thing. But let me remind you of something. None of us are worthy, even the greatest man or woman in this room is not worthy to come to this table on their own. We're all unworthy. However, through what Jesus has done and the promises we've heard today in the gospel, through Isaiah, Jesus makes us worthy. You are loved. You are forgiven. You're no more the one who whips Jesus. You become the one who Jesus was whipped for. You're no longer the one who shouts, crucify him. Instead, you're the one who he's crucified for. No more do you get the cup of judgment and the wrath of God poured out on you for eternity. Jesus had that done for you in the 3 hours of darkness on the cross. So as we come to this table, I encourage you to guard against coming in an unworthy way. Which means, don't come in ignorance. If you know Christ, you may come. Don't come with a lack of faith. Do you trust Christ? Are you ready to expand the tent? Are you ready to step out in faith as we've heard today?
Do you come with bitterness, full of hatred and sin in your heart? Don't do that. Come with healing and love. Do you have a profane, a wandering mind? Do you come with seriousness? If you do, then the Lord will receive you. If you are not guilty, you are justified. You are declared right. Your sins are forgiven, and you worship and commune with the triune God here. And so let us all stand together at this time. Brother Frank and I will be up front. And as we sing together, Brother Clarence is going to come through the room and he's going to dismiss one row at a time. You follow his lead and you come. Remember, you're not worthy. Jesus makes us worthy. Come. Now, we're going to be following sanitary practices. Those of you in the gym, please just stay where you're at. Two leaders will come to give you the bread and cup. I would ask you to put your hand out to receive. Don't grab, receive. That way we can keep a sanitary giving of the bread and the cup. And remember, let's worship God in this. He feeds us. It's the tree of life. It's the cup of salvation. He prepares this table before you because he loves you. Nothing will separate you from his love. Let's bow and give thanks to God for the bread and the cup. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this bread and this cup that you bless us with today. Help us now as we sing to you to worship you with our hearts. Help us now as we receive this, that we would do it in a worthy way, meaning we would know that you are worthy and you loved us so much that you gave your all for us, Christ. Feed us at this table, we pray in Jesus' holy name. And God's people said, amen. Amen. Please remain standing and sing to the Lord.
Can see all is mine, yet I love what you.
He has said that He will bring me home, and day by day I know He will renew me until I stand with joy before.
Our Lord Jesus, on the night which He was betrayed, having taken bread and blessed it, He broke it and gave it to His disciples, as I, ministering in His name, give this bread to you, saying, take, eat, this is the body of Jesus Christ, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of Him. After the same manner, our Savior also took the cup, and having given thanks, as has been done in His name, He gave it to His disciples, saying, this is a new testament, a new covenant, which is in my blood. Drink this in remembrance of me. Thanks be to God.
Just a few things to bring to your attention before we close out the service today. First off, a reminder that you can worship the Lord through giving. You can give online at lovepensacola.org/onlinegiving. We still are in need of money for our project renovating the gym to help with worship. So we thank the Lord. We had given this past week $1,350 towards that, which is almost half of what we needed towards that project. And if you would like to give in that way, you can give online, and that will definitely be a great blessing to the overflow worship, which will be going on for a while, maybe even perpetually. So we thank the Lord for those who have been able to give in that way. Secondly, want to let you know we have a volunteer need, and I believe Brother Luke is going to jump up here, and because we are out of time, he's going to give a quick announcement about an important ministry.
Thank you, Pastor Josh. So if you are in any way looking to serve, get plugged in here at church. Our sound team is an important ministry here to this church. And so we have some opportunities and availabilities back there, and we need help. So if you know anything about audio-visual, we do have some entry-level positions as far as just paying attention to the slide and clicking as we go. And to the most advanced positions and knowing all about the soundboard and the cameras and all that good stuff. So I won't keep any more. If you have any interest in that, see me after church. I'll be glad to talk more about that.
And the key is we'll train you. We will train you. All right. And we'll work with your schedule to get you as involved as you can be. Thank you so much, Brother Luke, for that. And then lastly, most excellent way, this Thursday night at 7 p.m., our addiction recovery ministry, know there is a safe place here. We are going to close out the service today. A reminder that as I close with our benediction, that I ask you to be seated and or remain seated, I should say, and that we'll dismiss you one row at a time. This is our practice right now because of the virus, just for everyone's well-being and to prevent any kind of spread of contagions. We'll say this, you're more than welcome to use the bathroom as you head out, but once you do that, or once you're dismissed, if you could make your way to your car right away so we don't have a gathering of people in our lobbies. Those of you in the overflow room as well, thanks for being here. If you will be dismissed as well, one group at a time, family group at a time, and if you would make your way out. So let's stand for our closing prayer, and then we will dismiss.
Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your goodness to us today, to meet with us, to speak to our hearts, to bless us through our brother Cody Mathews and this mighty word from the book of Isaiah. Thank you for this promise and prophecy of Christ and his death so that we would not need to fear, so that no weapon formed against us would prosper, because all of hell itself was thrown against you on the cross, Christ. And now we walk out of here in freedom, able to not only expect great things from you, but to attempt great things for you. So may we walk in faith this week, walk in Christ's love this week. And now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. And all God's people said, amen. Love God, love your neighbor, and go in his peace.